الله وبركاته. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدى هدى محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار. الحمد لله, we praise Allah and we seek His assistance and we seek His forgiveness. And we seek refuge in Allah from the evil within ourselves and from our bad deeds. Whoever Allah guides, there is none that can lead him astray, and whoever is led astray, then there is no guide for him. I bear witness that no God has the right to be worshipped other than Allah. He is alone and has no partners. And I bear witness that Muhammad is His slave and His messenger. O you who believe, fear Allah as you ought to be feared, and don't die except as Muslims. O humanity, fear your Lord who has created you from a single soul, and created from it its mate, and scattered from them too many men and women. And fear Allah for whom you demand your mutual rights, and don't cut off relations with the wounds that bore you. Indeed, Allah is a raqib over you. O you who believe, fear Allah and say that which is correct, in order that He may accept from you your deeds and forgive you of your sins. And whoever obeys Allah and His Messenger has achieved the greatest achievement. Amma ba'du, certainly the most truthful speech is the Book of Allah. And the finest guidance is the guidance of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the most evil of affairs are newly invented matters in this deen. And every newly invented matter in this deen is a bid'ah. And every bid'ah is a strang. And every strang is in the hellfire. Continuing our class, Etiquettes in Islam for the Women, and the book Ahkam al-Tifl, or the Verdicts Pertaining to Children, by Ahmed al-Aysa. We are just beginning the book of educating and raising our children properly. And today we are with the chapter باب تعليم الغلام قواعد الدين وأصوله, chapter teaching the young boys or the young children the basis or the fundamental principles of this deen. Before we begin this chapter, one of the brothers was asking, what are we going to do when we look at our children and it looks like they're going astray? Being guided and going astray is by the qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and He guides whoever He pleases and He leads astray whoever He pleases. That's the first point. And then the second point was that if we didn't know Islam and we didn't practice Islam, then what could we expect from our children? But now, alhamdulillah, as we're going over some of these hadith of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam, rather in many ayat from the Book of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, as explained by our Shaykh Ahmed al-Aysawi hafizahullah, if we don't practice what we know of this deen when it comes to raising our children, then we'd have no one to blame but ourselves. So let's not be too sad over what took place in the past. Whatever Allah has decreed is going to take place. And let's look forward, inshallah ta'ala, to the future by learning this deen and practicing this deen and raising our children on al-Islam. Imam al-Tirmidhi, rahimahullah, he says, and we brought the chain last week, where he comes down to Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, who said, كُنْتُ خَلْفَ النَّبِيِّ صَلَّى اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ يَوْمًا فَقَالَ يَا غُلَامٌ, to the end of that hadith. وَعَبْدُ اللَّهِ ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, ما He said that I was riding behind the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam one day, and he said, "O young child, indeed I will teach you a few phrases. Guard Allah and Allah would guard you. Guard Allah and you will find him in front of you. And if you ask, then ask Allah. And if you seek assistance, then seek assistance in Allah. And know that the whole world or the whole nations, if they were to gather together to benefit you by something, that they would only benefit you by that which Allah has already written for you. And if everyone got together to do you some harm, that they can only harm you with that which Allah had already written against you. The pens are lifted and the pages are dry." And this hadith of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we see that he's teaching the children, and in this case Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, some of the fine or the basic fundamental principles of this deen, al-Islam. As he begins with, guard Allah and Allah would guard you. Guarding Allah means to fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by obeying Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala's commandments. And amongst the things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has us to guard, which is probably more important than any other thing, is to guard the salat. To perform the salat properly, to know how to perform it properly, to perform it in its proper time, so that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can reward you and can safeguard you from committing sins, as your preserving or guarding your salat would help you ward off the evil, as Allah tabarak wa ta'ala tells us, إِنَّ الصَّلَاةَ تَنْهَى عَنِ الْفَحْشَاءِ وَالْمُنْكَرِ, that the salat prevents a person from doing abominable deeds and things that are wrong. So if we guard Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, then Allah would guard us. If we guard what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has us to guard, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will look out for us by rewarding us and safekeeping us here in this dunya. So this is the first principle that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is teaching him, that when Allah tabarak wa ta'ala sets the limits, to make sure you watch the limits set by Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, and to worship him as he ought to be worshipped, Azza wa Jal. And then the Messenger of Allah alayhi salatu wasalam, he says, if you ask, then only ask Allah. And this is the statement that we recite, and this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in Surah Al-Baqarah, وَإِذَا سَأَلَكَ عِبَادِي عَنِّي فَإِنِّي قَرِيبٌ أُجِيبُ دَعْوَةَ الدَّاعِ إِذَا دَعَانَ فَلْيَسْتَجِيبُ لِي وَلْيُؤْمِنُوا بِي لَعَلَّهُمْ يَرْشُدُونَ. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, if my servants ask you concerning me, then tell them that I am qareeb, that I am near, and I answer the dua of the one who asks it. So answer my call and believe in me so that you may be guided. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in this ayah and in many ayat, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala commands us to call on him. And Allah tabarak wa ta'ala tells us, وَأَنَّ الْمَسَاجِدَ لِلَّهِ فَلَا تَدْعُوا مَعَ اللَّهِ أَحَدًا, and the masjids are for Allah's alone, so don't call on anyone other than Allah. And the evidence of this issue of making the dua and of only asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are many. But here we see that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is teaching him the fundamental point of when you ask, ask Allah. And this is worship, as the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Ad-du'a huwa al-ibadah," in the authentic hadith. That dua, or the asking of Allah, is the worship. And the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, dua is worship, as if this is the only act of worship, is calling upon Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says this to show the importance of it. And this point we have to take in mind, and to raise our children upon this, to be used to asking Allah tabarak wa ta'ala and not asking the people. To be used to asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and not asking the people. I think we have covered in the past that one of the ways to Jannah is not to ask the people for anything. And that the companion who narrated this hadith from the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, even if he was riding on the horse and he dropped his whip, he wouldn't even ask someone to just pick it up for him. He jumped down off of his horse to pick it up himself. And this is what we should raise our children on, not to be begging, but to learn to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to be hard workers. As the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam goes on to say, if you seek assistance, seek assistance in Allah. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala teaches us, إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ. You alone do we worship, and you alone do we seek assistance. And that when we need help, we turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala firstly and foremost. And this is what the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is teaching us to bring up our children on. Not to always rely and to depend on the people, but to depend on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And to turn to Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala when a person needs help, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Him alone that we seek our help, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala teaches us in the Quran. And the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in the authentic hadith of Imam Muslim, he says, المؤمن القوي خير وأحب إلى الله من المؤمن الضعيف وفي كل خير احرص على ما ينفعك واستعن بالله ولا تعجز. To the end of that hadith, where the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, the strong believer is better and more beloved in the sight of Allah than the weak believer, and in all of them is good, and all of the Muslims there is some good, and this is their belief in Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, be eager to do that which will benefit you, and seek assistance in Allah, and don't feel incapable. So yeah, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is teaching us that nobody should feel incapable, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed all of us, alhamdulillah, and that we should seek assistance in Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala and do our best to do that which would benefit us, as the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is advising us. And these are the prime principles, or the basic fundamental principles, that we're going to raise our children upon, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is teaching Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu. And then the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam kind of summarizes it up with his statement, and know that if the whole world, or the whole ummah, the whole nations, if they were to gather to benefit you, then they can only benefit you with that which Allah has already written for you. And if they combine themselves together to do you some harm, then they can only harm you with that which Allah has written against you. The pen is lifted and the pages are dry. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam here is teaching the child the importance of our aqidah, and the proper belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And here the fundamental principle of qadr. And this is one of the arkan, or the pillars of our iman in Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, is that we believe that everything has already been preordained. That Allah has decreed everything 50,000 years before creation, as the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells us in the hadith of Imam Muslim. And this is important, that we raise our children on the correct aqidah from a very young age, as we see that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam is teaching the children, as this proper belief is that which is going to save them from the hellfire, inshaAllah ta'ala. Everyone, and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive us, everyone can fall into sin. But Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala can forgive all sins except the one that He says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَغْفِرُ أَن يُشْرَكَ بِهِ وَيَغْفِرُ مَا دُونَ ذَلِكَ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ. That Allah would not forgive that you commit shirk, that you ascribe partners with Allah, that you worship other than Allah along with Allah. But He will forgive anything less than that to whoever He pleases. So it's important to raise our children on this tawheed, and on the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the belief in what Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala has us to believe in. Because no matter how far, inshallah, that they fall short, or if they become a sinner, if their belief is correct, then they will always repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to desire the Jannah, and to be fearful of the hellfire. And this is very important in the lives of the children. And some of us, alhamdulillah, who have had a chance to meet the Muslims who are born and raised in Islam, the worst amongst them understand that there's a Jannah and a hellfire. And the worst amongst them understand that they must repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala is the only one that has the right to be worshipped. So even if a person strays a little, he still knows who his Lord is, tabaraka wa ta'ala, and that he knows that he has to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to stand before Him on what he does. And he knows that the door of repentance is open for him. And this is important for our children to understand, so that when they grow up, inshallah ta'ala, they won't grow up like some of the Muslim children have grown up to say, Abi, I'm a Catholic. And there are other cases, and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to save our children. But the saving of our children starts off with teaching them the very fundamentals of this deen, as the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is teaching them in this deen, in this hadith. And I'm very deficient in my explanation of this hadith, as our Shaykh had given it a very full explanation. And this is one of the hadith, of the 40 hadith, and Ibn Rajab Al-Hanbali rahimahullah had given this hadith a big, very very big explanation because of the importance of the hadith. And this is what the scholars have, and we can only present what we have. At any rate, we see from this hadith that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam teaches him to stay on the worship of Allah, and that we have been created to worship Allah, as Allah tells us, وَمَا خَلَقَتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. And I have not created the jinn nor the mankind except to worship me. And here the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is teaching the child at a very young age, be mindful to worship Allah. This is your purpose in life. Whatever you grow up to be, whether it's a doctor, a teacher, a fireman, or what have you, that you know that your main purpose in life is to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then after that, you do whatever you have to do to maintain yourself and your family in this world. And the Messenger of Allah alayhi salatu wasalam teaches them on top of that too, when you worship Allah and fulfill your purpose in life, then you will be rewarded with Jannah. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala rewards you when you worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And likewise, the opposite, if you don't guard Allah, that which Allah has said to be guarded, then you set yourself up for the punishment of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, and we ask Allah not to punish me. And then the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam teaches the child to develop a close relationship with Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. That teaches him whenever he wants to ask, whenever he is in need, to turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and not to always feel so weak and incapable and dependent upon the people, but to depend on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to develop a close relationship with his Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala, because Allah tabarak wa ta'ala is the only one that can help him or harm him. As the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is showing us in the next statements, in the belief in the qadr, that Allah has already decreed what's going to take place. And this is to encourage our children to be brave and not to be cowards, so that they can stand up and to defend and to fight for the deen of Al-Islam, and not to worry about death, because nothing can take place except that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decreed. And you become brave and not a coward when you believe in the qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because you aren't worried about the people. You aren't worried that they're going to really benefit you or harm you. You rely on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and you try to do that which will benefit you. And then whatever the outcome is, then you know it's from the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is why the Messenger of Allah alayhi salatu wasalam says, as we paraphrase in his authentic hadith, this is why I'm amazed at the believer. Because if something good befalls him, he praises Allah and he's happy. And if something bad befalls him, he praises Allah. And he knows that this is from the decree of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to write for us all that is good, and to save us from all that is evil. The next chapter is Bab Istihbabu Ta'aleem Al-Sabi Adab Al-Akli Wa-Shurb. Chapter, the recommendation to teach the child. And here the ulama, they explain that the child, in the same case that we're referring to the first hadith, is that this is from a young age to before the age of puberty. So this is all before the age of puberty. To teach, the recommendation to teach the child the etiquettes of eating and drinking. In the hadith of Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah, where he says, حَدَّثَنَا عَلِيَ بُنُ عَبِدِ اللَّهِ قال أخبرنا سفيان قال الوليد بن كثير أخبرني أنه سمع وهب بن كيسان أنه سمع عمر بن أبي سلمة يقول كنت غلاما في حجر رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وكانت يدي تطيش في الصحفة فقال لي رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يا غلام سم الله وقل بيمينك وقل مما يليك فما زالت تلك طعمتي بعد. And this hadith is also collected by Imam Muslim. Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah, he says that it was narrated to us by Ali ibn Abdullah, who said that it was reported to us by Sufyan, who said that Al-Walid ibn Kathir said that it was that he reported to that Al-Walid ibn Kathir reported to me that he heard Wahb ibn Kaysan that he heard Umar ibn Abi Salama say, I was a child under the care of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and my hand used to roam around in the plea. And the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to me, O boy, say Bismillah, eat with your right hand and eat that which is closest to you. And this is was the way that I ate afterwards. And this hadith of Umar ibn Abi Salama, and Umar ibn Abi Salama is the Rabib of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, the son of Salama, the mother of the believers radiyallahu anha wa radiyallahu anhu. So this is the foster son or the stepson of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. He was born in Al-Habasha, in Abyssinia or Ethiopia, in the second year of Hijrah, and this was because they had made Hijrah from Mecca to Habasha before the Hijrah to the Medina of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Al-Madina. And we know what took place, and then the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam had married his mother later on after that. He was the governor or in charge of Al-Bahrain, that we know now on the eastern part of the Arabian Peninsula, during the time of Ali radiallahu anhu. He also fought in the battles with Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu, and he died in Medina the year of 83 Hijrah during the Khilaf of Abdul Malik ibn Marwan rahimahumullah ajma'in. At any rate, we see that Umar ibn Abi Salama was the stepson or the foster son of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wasallam. And I wanted to mention this to show that we have the same cases with our stepchildren, and whether it's your child or your wife's child, that it's important that you educate them and you upbring them or you raise them on this deen of al-Islam and the etiquettes of a Muslim, as the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam here is teaching him when his hand was roaming around, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, roaming around in the plate, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught him the etiquettes of eating. And not to just leave him ignorant and say, that's my wife, that's your boy, teach him some Islam. But that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught him these three etiquettes, or three of the etiquettes of eating, and that is that you say Bismillah before you begin, and to eat with your right hand, and to eat that which is closest to you on the plate. The next chapter Mata Yasihu Sima'u Sabiyyi As-Saghir. When do we accept the understanding of a small child? And this is from the title of Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah in his Sahih al-Bukhari, where, and we brought this hadith, and this hadith is going to come in other places, where Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhumah, he says, أَقْبَلْتُ رَاكِبًا عَلَى حِمَارِ أَتَانِ وَأَنَا يَوْمَئِذٍ قَدْ نَاهَزْتُ الْإِحْتِلَامِ ورسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يصلي بمنى إلى غير جدار فمررت بين يدي بعض الصف وأرسلت الأتان ترتع فدخلت في الصف فلم ينكر ذلك علي. And this authentic hadith, Abdullah ibn Abbas رضي الله عنهما, he says that I came up while I was riding on a female donkey, and I was at the time just about to reach the age of puberty. And the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was making salat without in front of him any wall. Or as some of the ulama say, as Imam al-Shafi'i rahimahullah says, without a sutra. So I walked in front of some of the rows, and then I let my donkey go to eat, and then I entered the rows, and then there was nothing said against what I did. And this hadith of Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma, Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah, he brings this hadith to show that young children understand. That young children can understand, and if they understand, then it's acceptable from them. Also, Al-Hafiz ibn Hajar, he says, pertaining to what Imam al-Bukhari intends to bring by this chapter, when the child's understanding is acceptable, is that they want to show that there's no condition on how old a person must be, or that a child must be in the age of puberty before anyone accepts his understanding, but that we can accept his understanding when the child, even if the child is before puberty, so long as the child understands. As the ulama explained, that the issue isn't how old the child is, but that the issue is if the child understands or not. If the child understands or not. Yes?
I don't understand. You mentioned about the subject.
Yeah. Abdullah ibn Abbas, the Prophet ﷺ in the mar making salat in Mina. Abdullah ibn Abbas was running in front of the rows before he actually got in the row. Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah is using this to show that children understand, as he knows what he's doing. You know, even when he's running, alright, it's time for salat, the Muslims are lined up. Even though he's not at the age of puberty, okay, he knows he has to get in the lines, or he walked in front of them. The Messenger of Allah alayhi salatu wasalam didn't say anything against it. That shows he knew what he was doing. He knew that there's no harm to walk in front of the rows when they're lining up, when the Muslims are making salah. And he also knows that when he sees the Muslims making salah, he's supposed to join the ranks and make the salah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best, as they didn't really explain the connection between this and a child understanding. And this is what I see, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. As the people know that Imam al-Bukhari is known as the Sayyidul Fuqaha, or the master of the one with the understanding of the hadith of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or as they say, the best of the people of fiqh, rahimahullah. And sometimes Imam al-Bukhari uses a hadith, and when the people come after him from the ulama, they're left bewildered, just to say, Allah knows best why Imam al-Bukhari put this hadith here. And this is what I saw from it, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. Al-Hafiz ibn Hajar, though, he did say that we see from this hadith that you put that it's permissible to to place something that is more beneficial above something that isn't so bad. Let me try to explain a little better with the example. Walking in front of the rows distracts the people. Lining up in the salat is very important. So he's overlooking that minor distraction in order to line up with the rows. Instead of saying, for example, if the rows are tight and there's no way to enter the masjid, like in our masjid for example, that instead of sitting over there and saying, no, I'm not going to distract the people making salah because I wouldn't want anybody to distract me, I'm going to wait till the salah is over and the people move out the way and then go and make my salah. But to put above this minor, it's not so bad, of distracting the people for that which is more important than it, of establishing the salah in the congregation. So here the Shaykh is trying to say that we have to be wise to in our deen, that sometimes you might have to do something that is a little discouraged or isn't so good in order to establish that which is better. Or as some of the people say, that you choose the lesser of the two evils or something like that, where you take into consideration that which is more important over that which is less important. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. Yes. Yes. That the sutra for the imam is the sutra for the people behind the imam. And in this hadith, it said that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam made salat ila ghayri jidar, or not to a wall. And Imam al-Shafi'i said that this was not to a sutra. If the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam didn't have a sutra, and his sutra would have been the sutra for the people behind him, then how do we say that there's no problem that Abdullah ibn Abbas walked in front of the rose? I didn't have time to review this point, just to double check, as our Shaykh Muhammad ibn Riz al-Tarhuni Hafizullah have wrote a nice book on the verdicts pertaining to the sutra. And I had thought that I had remembered that it didn't say that the Prophet ﷺ didn't make salat to a sutra. It said he made salat not facing a wall. And that the Messenger of Allah ﷺ didn't say anything about him going through the ranks. And we know that the Prophet ﷺ is the one that commanded us to make the salat to the sutra. So it must be obvious that there was something there other than a wall, as it would be in the masjid, as you make your sutra is the wall. And when you're outside, something else is your sutra. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. What is important, though, to understand that sometimes when we read the hadith and there are a lot of stories and things are being said, that in those cases you're not quick to take a verdict from it unless the ulama take a verdict from it. And the hadith is clear from the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam: "La tusalli illa ila sutra." Don't make salah except to a sutra, and then get close to it. So this statement of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam shows that it's compulsory for the people to make a sutra. And at best, some of the ulama say about this hadith that this shows that the sutra isn't necessarily compulsory, but it's recommended. And those who say that it's compulsory have stronger evidences, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. The next hadith of Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah, he says, حدثني محمد بن يوسف قال حدثنا أبو مصهر قال حدثني محمد بن حرب قال حدثني الزبيدي عن الزهري عن محمود بن الربيع قال عقلت من النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم محجة مجها في وجهي وأنا ابن خمس سنين من دلو. And this was also collected by Imam Muslim, where Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah, he said that it was narrated to me by Muhammad ibn Yusuf, who said that it was narrated to us by Abu Mus'har, who said that it was narrated to me by Muhammad ibn Harbin, who said that it was narrated to me by Az-Zubaydi on the authority of Az-Zuhri, on the authority of Mahmud ibn Rabi', who said that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or I memorized that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam spit out some water in my face when I was only 5 years from a big pail of water. Imam al-Bukhari, and as our Shaykh Ahmed al-Aysawi hafizahullah wa rahimahullah, and Imam al-Bukhari is using this hadith to show that young children understand. And this is from the point that he said it was 5 years old, and I remember the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam spit in my face some water from a bucket, and I was only 5 years old. And Mahmud ibn Rabi' radiallahu anhu He's Ibn Suraqa al-Ansari, from the Ansar, Abu Muhammad, and he lived in Medina, and he died in the year 99 Hijra, and he was 93 years old. So he was 5 years old when this took place, rahimahullah, and this was shortly before the death of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And he remembered when he was an older man, as he's narrating this hadith to the tabi'een who came after him. And this shows that the children, they know what takes place and they know what happens and they can understand, and that we should understand that not all children are the same, and not to say wait until you get older, boy, you'll understand. But that some of the children, they memorize and they understand at a very young age, even at the age of 5. And this shows that we should start teaching them the sunnah and to memorize the book of Allah, the Quran, and the etiquettes of Islam even at a very young age. Because many of the children, they do understand at a young age and they do remember, as we see in this case of Muhammad ibn Rabi' radiallahu anhu. Al-Hafidh ibn Hajar, he explains also that we see in this hadith that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was playing with him when he spit the water in his face. And maybe those were in the days before the water gun where you just put some water in your mouth and then you just spit it out. You know, if you put a lot of water in your mouth and you spit it out, like some of us used to do when we used to play in the pool or whatever, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was playing with him, and not that he's spitting on him sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was trying to bless him with the water from the mouth of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And we see that this was very common with the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as he used to do this with his companions. We also see from this hadith, as Al-Hafidh ibn Hajar is explaining, that the young children can sit in the lessons of hadith, or really, that's what they used to say in the past, or that they can sit in the gatherings of knowledge, like in the lectures, in the classes. The little children, they can sit and understand. And sometimes we see one of the boys, the brother, brings his son, and he always has a question at the end, and he's paying attention, and the children, they do remember, as we see from this case. We also see from this hadith that the imam visits his companions in their houses and plays with their children. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us to practice the sunnah. So Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah, he's using this hadith to show that, and the shaykh, he's using both of these hadith to show that children do understand. And we can start to teach our children at a young age, as alhamdulillah we're trying to do in the Islamic day school, and I think they're starting the children at 2.5 years old. And then they're beginning the children, alhamdulillah, at a very young age in order to teach them Islam so that they can grow up and to be a good generation of Muslims, inshallah. The next chapter, Bab Rahmatul Waladi wa Taqbiluhu wa Mu'aniqatuhu. Chapter showing mercy to the child and kissing him and hugging him. And the hadith of Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah, where he says, حدثنا أبو اليمام قال أخبرنا شعيب عن الزهري قال حدثنا أبو سلمة ابن عبد الرحمن أن أبا هريرة رضي الله عنه قال قبل رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم الحسن بن العلي وعنده الأقرع بن حابس التميمي جالسا فقال الأقرع إن لي عشرة من الولد ما قبلت منهم أحدا وفي رواية ما قبلت إنسانا قط فنظر إليه رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ثم قال من لا يرحم لا يرحم. Imam al-Bukhari رحمه الله, he says that it was reported, narrated to us by Abu al-Yaman, who said that it was reported to us by Shu'ayb on the authority of Zuhri, who said that it was narrated to us by Abu Salama ibn Abd al-Rahman, that Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu, he said that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam kissed al-Hassan ibn Ali, or the grandson of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And al-Aqra ibn Habis al-Tamimi was sitting there with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And al-Aqra, he said, I have 10 children. and I haven't kissed any one of them ever. Or in one of the narrations, I never kissed anybody ever. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam looked at him and said, whoever doesn't show mercy won't have mercy shown on him. And we see from this hadith of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam being merciful to the children. And we see from this hadith of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam kissing of the children. And here Al-Hafiz ibn Hajar, he says that in this answer of the, or the statement of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we see that kissing the children, rather our wives and the people who are mahram for, and even other than them, is from the issue of showing mercy and being affectionate, and not for the issue of pleasure or fulfilling of your desires. So we see from this hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, one of the ways to show mercy to our children by kissing them. Al-Aqra ibn Habis ibn Iqal ibn Muhammad ibn Sufyan al-Tamimi al-Darimi, he fought or he was there during the conquest of Mecca and in the battle of Hunayn and al-Ta'if, and he was from the people who newly embraced Islam at that time, and alhamdulillah he had did good when he became a Muslim, rahimahullah or radiyallahu anhu, and that they used to call him Aqra' because he used to be bald-headed, and Aqra' means bald, and that's why they used to call him. And they said that he used to be noble in Jahiliyyah and noble in Islam, as he was a judge in the days of Jahiliyyah, and then he did good in Islam, radiyallahu anhu. And this is a side benefit that I wanted to add from this hadith, and that is, when you first hear the hadith, you say, how can somebody be so hard? And I wanted to show that he did good in his Islam. And that sometimes we may have some things with us from Jahiliyyah that aren't so good, but that the people, alhamdulillah, after the guidance of Islam, leave them to practice this deen of al-Islam. So this shows us that no one should just have an excuse, as this is the way I used to do in Jahiliyyah after the guidance of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because you weren't the first people to accept Islam and to change your ways of Jahiliyyah, as we see from the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa alihi wasallam, that they accepted Islam and that they had stuff with them, and that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam came to teach them and to purify them and to show them what was wrong from the things that they had from Jahiliyyah, and then they changed, as the ulama of Islam explained that he did good in his Islam, radiyallahu anhu. The next hadith of Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah, where he says, حدثنا محمد بن يوسف قال حدثنا سفيان عن هشام عن عروة عن عائشة رضي الله عنها قالت جاء أعرابي إلى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فقال تقبلون الصبيان فما نقبلهم وفي رواية والله ما نقبلهم فقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أو أملك لك أن نزع الله من قلبك الرحمة. And this is also collected by Imam Muslim, where Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah, he says that it was reported to us by Muhammad ibn Yusuf, who said that it was reported to us by Sufyan on the authority of Hisham, on the authority of Urwa, on the authority of Aisha radiallahu anha, that she said, a desert Arab or a Bedouin Arab came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and asked him, do you kiss the children? Like being surprised that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam would kiss children. We don't kiss children. And in another narration, I swear by Allah, we don't kiss no children. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, am I the one who has the ability to put mercy in your heart after Allah took it out? And the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is here going against or opposing this action of the man by not kissing the children, showing that this is no mercy. And that if a person, after he sees the guidance of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is kissing the children, you're going to ask, you kissing the children, Ya Rasulullah? Like, what you think you're doing? Nobody don't kiss no children.
And the people, unfortunately, are still saying this after the guidance of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam comes. We don't do that. As in the example of the issue that causes a lot of problems, this issue of wearing our pants above the ankles. When the hadith of the Messenger of Allah alayhi salatu wasalam comes to us, مَا أَسْفَلَ مِنَ الْكَعْبَيْنِ فَفِي النَّارِ, that whatever is below the ankle is in the hellfire, we say, we don't do that, that's high waters. Everybody know you don't wear high waters, and that ain't no style. And this is almost like what the person is doing in this hadith, that you see the guidance of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and then you say, we don't do that. And then the Prophet ﷺ is saying, am I going to put some mercy in your heart after Allah took it out of you? Or in any case, am I going to be the one that put you on the Siratul Mustaqim after Allah led you off of it? So it's important that we show mercy to our children and to be gentle with them by kissing them. As the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam used to kiss the children. Imam Muslim rahimahullah, he says, حَدَّثَنَا زُهَيْرُ بْنُ حَرْبٍ ومحمد بن عبد الله بن نمير واللفظ لزهير قال حدثنا إسماعيل وهو بن علي عن أيوب عن عمرو بن سعيد عن أنس بن مالك رضي الله عنه قال ما رأيت أحدا كان أرحم بالعيال من رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال كان إبراهيم مسترضعا له في عوالي المدينة فكان ينطلق ونحن معه فيدخل البيت وإنه لا يدخن وكان ذئره قينا فيأخذه فيقبله ثم يرجع. In this hadith, Imam Muslim rahimullah, he says that it was narrated to us by Zuhair ibn Harban and Muhammad ibn Abdullah ibn Numair. And this narration is from Zuhair ibn Harb, and both of them narrated, reported to us by Ismail, and he is Ibn Uliya on the authority of Ayyub, on the authority of Amr ibn Sa'idin, on the authority of Anas ibn Malik and radiallahu anhu, who said, I never saw anyone who was more merciful to his family than the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, Ibrahim, and this is Ibrahim ibn Muhammad ibn Abdullah ibn Abdul Muttalib sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wa radiallahu an his son Ibrahim, who used to be breastfed in Awali of Al-Madina. And this is an area there in Medina. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to go visit Ibrahim while he was being breastfed in this area of Al-Madina. And we used to be with the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then he would enter the house, wa innahu la yuddakhan, and I forgot what that means. And there would be the lady who was breastfeeding the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's child, Ibrahim, who died as a child, radiallahu anhu. And the Prophet ﷺ would take his son, and then he would kiss him, and then he would give it back, sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. And this is just showing that the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, would kiss his child. And this is advice for the parents, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best, the parents who don't have custody of their children, to make sure that they pay a visit to their children, and to show their children that they love them by kissing them, as the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam used to kiss his children. Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah, he says, حَدَّثَنَا ابْنُ أَبِي مَرْيَمَ قَالَ حَدَّثَنَا أَبُو غَسَّانَ قَالَ حَدَّثَنِي زَيْدُ بْنُ أَسْلَمَ عَنْ أَبِيهِ عَنْ عُمَرَ بْنُ الْخَطَّابِ رضي الله عنه قال قدم على النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم صبي فإذا امرأة من الصبي تحلب ثديها تسقي إذا وجدت صبيا في السبا أو في السبي أو سبي أو سبا أخذته فألفقته ببطنها وأرضعته فقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أترون هذه طارحة ولدها في النار قلنا لا وهي تقدر على أن لا تطرحها
فطروحه فقال لله أرحم بعباده من هذه بولدها. Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah, he says that it was reported to us by Ibn Abi Maryam, who said that it was reported to us by Abu Ghassan, who said that it was reported to me by Zayd ibn Aslam on the authority of his father, on the authority of Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, who said that some war captives had come to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And there was a lady from amongst the war captives who used to breastfeed the children. And then when she found her own child, she put the child close to her stomach and breastfed her child. And the Prophet ﷺ said, do you think that this lady would throw away her child in the hellfire? And they said, no, if she has the ability not to throw her child in the fire. And the Prophet ﷺ said, I swear by Allah that Allah is more merciful to His servants than this lady is to her child. So here we see from this hadith of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala is more merciful to His slaves than any of us can be to each other. But this isn't to discourage us, but this is to encourage us to be more merciful to one another. As Al-Hafidh ibn Hajjah, he says from this hadith that we see that it's very necessary and important for a person to connect himself or to develop his relationship with Allah alone in all of his affairs. And that everyone who has everyone should be concerned with being merciful and to be merciful for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, knowing that Allah is going to be more merciful than you could ever be. So this should encourage a person, if he knows that someone is in need, to be merciful to that person. And what the Shaykh rahimahullah is trying to show us, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best, if we know that Allah is more merciful to His servants than any of us could be to one another, then we should be trying to do our best to be as merciful as we can to one another and to our children especially, so that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can be more merciful than that to us on Yawm al-Qiyamah. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for His mercy. And Al-Hafidh ibn Hajar rahimahullah, he says that what is meant by His servants or Allah's servants here are those who die on Al-Islam. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. In the next hadith of Imam Muslim rahimahullah, he says, حَدَّفَنَا زُهَيْرَ بْنُ حَرْبٍ وَإِسْحَاقِ بْنُ إِبْرَاهِيمِ كِلَاهُمَا عَنْ جَرِيرٍ. And there's another chain, وَحَدَّفَنَا إِسْحَاقِ بْنُ إِبْرَاهِيمِ وَعَلِي بْنُ خَشْرَمْ قَالَ أَخْبَرَنَا عِيسَى بْنُ يُونُسِ. And then there's another chain, وَحَدَّفَنَا أَبُو كُرَيْبٍ مُحَمَّدِ بْنُ الْعَلَى قَالَ حَدَّفَنَا أَبُو مُعَاوِيَةَ. And then there's another chain, وَحَدَّفَنَا أَبُو سَعِيدٍ الْأَشَجِّ قَالَ حَدَّفَنَا حَفْصٌ يَعْنِي ابْنُ غَيَّاثٍ كلهم عن الأعمش عن زيد بن وهب وأبي ظبيان عن جرير عن جرير بن عبد الله قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ما لا يرحم من لا يرحم الناس لا يرحمه الله عز وجل. Imam Muslim, he brings his different chains down to Al-A'mash on the authority of Zayd ibn Wahb and Abi Dhibyan on the authority of Jarir ibn Abdullah radiallahu anhu, who said that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, whoever does not show mercy to the people, Allah azza wa jal will not show mercy to him. And this is advice and maybe even a warning to the parents to make sure that they're merciful to their children, so that Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala can be merciful to them on Yawm al-Qiyamah. And from this mercy is that which the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to do, of kissing the children to show his mercy, and also by hugging them. And the Shaykh didn't bring any hadith that shows that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was hugging them. And maybe we can take, for example, the hadith of Imam al-Nasa'i, where the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was giving the khutbah, and al-Hassan and al-Hussein, they were stumbling in the masjid as they were so young. They were at the age when they were just learning to walk, and they were walking and falling down, and the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam stopped his khutbah, got off the minbar, and picked them up and hugged them, and recited the ayat, إنما أولادكم started the ayah from the end of Surah Taghabun. إنما أموالكم وأولادكم فتنة. Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala says, indeed your wealth and your children are a fitna. So the Messenger of Allah, he stopped his khutbah on Yawmul Jumu'ah, got off the minbar and picked up his children, picked up his grandchildren, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, wa radiallahu anhuma, and then he hugged them, then he put them down, and he got back on the minbar and began giving the continuing the khutbah, sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam. So all of this is a part of being merciful to our children, and maybe amongst the biggest mercy to our children is that which was mentioned in the beginning of this class, of teaching our children this deen. And this is the biggest mercy that we can give to our children, is to save them from the hellfire by teaching them to believe in Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, and to worship Him, and to follow the guidance of His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam. The next chapter, bab wadu sabi al fakhdi wa fil hajr, chapter placing the child on the thigh or the lap. In the hadith of Imam Bukhari rahimullah, where he says, حدثني عبد الله بن محمد قال حدثنا عارم قال حدثنا المعتمد المعتمر ابن سليمان يحدث عن أبيه قال سمعت أبا تميم يحدث عن أبي عثمان النهدي يحدثه أبو عثمان عن أسامة ابن زيد رضي الله عنهما كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يأخذني فيقعدني على فخذه ويقعد الحسن على فخذه الآخر ثم يضمهما ثم يقول اللهم ارحمهما فإني أرحمهما. In this authentic hadith where Imam al-Bukhari brings his chain to the Usama ibn Zayd ibn Haritha radiallahu anhuma, that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to place me on one of his thighs, and then he would place al-Hasan on the other thigh, and then he hugged both of us, and then he said, O Allah, show your mercy on both of them, because indeed I am merciful to both of them. So we see in this hadith that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he used to place the children on his thighs sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and that here we see the hadith where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is actually hugging them, and this is how the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam shows his mercy to the children, and he made the dua that Allah show his mercy to them. And we should make dua that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be merciful to our children. O Allah, be merciful to our children as we try to be merciful to our children. The next hadith of Imam al-Bukhari, he says, حدثنا محمد بن مثنى قال حدثنا يحيى بن سعيد عن هشام قال أخبرني أبي عن عائشة أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وضع صبيا في حجره يحنكه فبال عليه فدعا بماء فأتبعه صلى الله عليه وسلم. Imam al-Bukhari, he says that it was narrated to us by Muhammad ibn Muthanna, who said that it was narrated to us by Yahya ibn Sa'idan on the authority of Hisham, who said that it was reported to me by my father on the authority of Aisha radiallahu anha, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam put a child in his lap, and then he yuhannikuhu, then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to eat the date, chew it up, and then put it in the mouth of the child, and then the child urinated on the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the Prophet asked for some water and then washed it off. And we see from this hadith that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to put the children in his lap sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and this is being merciful to them, and this is a part of the etiquettes that we use with the children. And we see from this hadith the humbleness
of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam by putting the children in his lap. And we see his gentleness and his mercy and his compassion for the children. And we see how the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has been generous to the parents by holding their child. We also benefit from this hadith that all of us should be gentle to the children and to be patient with the abuse that we find from the children, and not to hold them accountable as they aren't even accountable for their own selves before this, the age of puberty. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. So we see from this guidance of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam to be patient with what the children do, and not to always holler and cry over spilled milk, but just to wipe it up, to clean up after the children, and to be merciful to them as the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was merciful to them. Rather, to be merciful to our children so that Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala to be merciful to us. And this is what we wanted to present today from our book on raising the children. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabiyyina Muhammad. Wa subhanaka Allahumma wa bihamdika ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. I don't know if there were any questions related to today's talk. I don't know if there were any questions or comments from Greensboro.
Yes, there is a question, Brother Man. The question is, are there legal excuses?
You have to raise your voice a little bit.
All right, can you hear me now?
Yes.
My question is, are there legal excuses for 10-year-olds who are obligated to pray, who take shahada, as there are obligations on... Obviously, the 20-plus-year-olds, are the standards the same?
I don't think I'll be a little loud. No, you have to repeat the question. It's not that clear.
My question is, for a 10-year-old who takes his shahada, or her shahada, are they under the same obligations as a 21-year-old or plus self?
Let's try answering the question like this. Whoever accepts Islam has to practice Islam. And what is for the Muslims is for that Muslim. And what is against the Muslims is against that Muslim. What is compulsory for the Muslims is compulsory for him. And what is haram for the Muslims is haram for him. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. I think we're going to deal with some chapters a little closer to that in the future, inshallah ta'ala, to maybe put things in a better perspective, and Allah knows best.
Shukran, I do have another question.
Yes.
The question is, it would be a great aid to us if you could repeat the questions that you are answering so that we can have the proper context so that we can follow your answers, inshallah.
I still didn't hear. Inshallah ta'ala. I don't know if the brothers and sisters from Asbury Park had any questions.
No, we don't, akhi.
Allah ybarak fikum. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to benefit us by the hadith of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and to help us raise our children on Islam. Ameen. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.